Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are stilled, when striving cease. My comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand.
In Christ alone, who took on flesh, fullness of God in helpless babe, the gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones he came to save.
Till on that cross as Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied.
For every sin on him was laid, there in the death of Christ I live.
Body lay, light of the world with darkness slain, then bursting forth in glorious day, up from the grave he rose again. And as he stands in victory, sin's charms has lost its grip on me. And he is mine, bought with the precious blood of Christ. No guilt in life, no fear in death, this is the power of Christ in me. From life's first cry to final breath, Jesus commands my destiny. No power of man or scheme of man can ever pluck me from his hand, till he returns or calls me home. Here in the power of Christ I'll stand. Till he returns or calls me home, here in the power of Christ I'll stand.
In Christ.
Amen. Thank you, guys. Good job. Well, I'm going to ask if you will find Acts chapter 18, and we're going to finish what we started last week. If you were here last week, you remember we shared half of what we had from Acts 18, speaking about using our giftedness and our talents and our abilities and everything that we have and are for the glory of God. And so we want to finish that up today. As you're turning, though, I want to agree with what Stephen has already told you, thanking you for all that you did this last week. We did have over 25 of our people there Thursday night, or here Thursday night. If you weren't able to be here, though, let me share this. all of the candy that you brought, every bit of it, is gone. If y'all hadn't brought the extra candy, we would have closed the doors at 6:30. I mean, we had that many people coming through. But also at Circle Ranch, I don't know if you're aware of it or not, but we have still money budgeted for children's ministry. And so the games and the prizes, we buy stuff from Oriental Trading, which you know that's like just little cheap stuff. But the kids love getting it. And so the monies that you give on a weekly basis, we use some of that to buy the gifts and the toys and things like that. So you feel like you were a part of it because you were. We would have all had to divvy it in and come up with prizes and all that had we not had that money budgeted. And so thank you for what you do. Now I see a whole bunch of folks fanning. If I go over here and turn this air conditioner on, am I going to be in trouble? No, okay, good. I'm just going to bump it a little, just a little. It may not even come on. One more. I'll bump it back up in a minute when it gets cool. How about that? Well, all right. I want to read from Acts chapter 18, and you can just remain seated as we read through this again. Same thing that we read last week, but beginning in verse 1. Paul says, after these things, Paul departed from Athens and went to Corinth. And after he found a certain Jew named Aquila, born in Pontus, who had recently come from Italy with his wife Priscilla, because Claudius had commanded all the Jews to depart from Rome, and he came to them. So because he was of the same trade, he stayed with them and worked. For by occupation they were tent makers, and he reasoned in the synagogue every Sabbath and persuaded both Jews and Greeks. And when Silas and Timothy had come from Macedonia, Paul was compelled by the Spirit and testified to the Jews that Jesus is the Christ. But when they opposed him and blasphemed, he shook his garments and said to them, your blood be upon your own heads, I am clean. From now on I will go to the Gentiles. And he departed from there, and he entered the house of a certain man named Justus, one who worshipped God, whose house was next door to the synagogue. And then Crispus, the ruler of the synagogue, believed on the Lord with all of his household. And many of the Corinthians, hearing, believed and were baptized. Now the Lord spoke to Paul in the night by a vision. Do not be afraid, but speak and do not keep silent, for I am with you. And no one will attack you to hurt you, for I have many people in this city. And he continued there a year and 6 months, teaching the word of God among them. We'll stop there. I want us to pray together now, but I want us to also pray. Election Day is Tuesday, and I know you remember that, but I think as a church family, we need to be sure we're praying God's will be done for our nation. These are uncertain times. I can just say it that way. And we absolutely need the Lord to be in charge of our country, our nation. And so let's pray. Let's pray over our study today, but let's pray for our nation together as well. Our Father, God, we do bow in your presence, Lord, and we understand that, Lord, we're at your mercy. God, that you're able to raise up, you're able to tear down. Lord, you're able to give, and you're able to take away as you so choose. And Lord, as a nation follows you, you bless. Lord, you provide, you protect. And God, we have experienced that our entire life, how you have been so good to us here in the United States, in America, Lord. We have been a blessed nation above all other countries, without any question. Father, we thank you for that. We praise you for that. But Lord, we would confess to you that, God, as a nation, we have turned our back on you. Lord, we are no longer one nation under God. And Father, we ask that you forgive us of that. I pray, Lord, that your people, your church, bows before you in repentance, Lord, and that we might seek your face and seek your will. And God, as our nation gathers together on Tuesday to elect a new leader, Father, we pray your will is done. Lord, I ask, God, that you would raise up that person that you have called, that you've chosen to be our next leader. And Lord, it may be they lead us even further away from you. It may be, Lord, we're reaping what we're sowed in the past. But God, we know that your will is always perfect in its best. And so, Lord, we pray that thy will is done in our country and our nation this coming week. Now, Father, as we study this word together, Lord, I pray that you challenge us, remind us of our calling, and may we be faithful to it. And Father, we ask it in your name. Amen. Amen. Well, last week we started this text, and if you remember, we're speaking about the giftedness that God, how God gifts us, how God provides us talents, abilities, and we're to use those for His honor and glory. We've been going through parables, and as we've studied the parable, we've tried to take it to the book of Acts and apply it, see how the early church has applied it. And so we have been studying on the giftedness, and really we were studying judgment to come, and how important it is that the church be the church, so that those one day standing before God will not stand in unrighteousness, but they will be clothed with the righteousness of Christ because they've heard the message. They've heard from you, and they've heard from me. And so we've come to the book of Acts, and we find this chapter 18, and where the Apostle Paul has left this city of Athens, where he had a ministry had begun. They were reaching some people, and he goes to this place called Corinth, and Corinth is a most wicked city. Corinth was one of those vile places where you would not want to stay and live. Paul's going to end up staying there for 18 months because that's where God sends him. But while he's here, we find that Paul uses many gifts, many abilities for the glory of God. And so we've looked at those, three of those, and we're going to look at three more today, just to show you how it is that we can serve God, and it's just like we did this weekend, by handing out candy to children and their parents and getting to know them. By the way, the first 50 at least that came through, we had bags made up already with gospel tracts in them. And then those ladies who were registering, as they could, they put tracts in the baskets of the next 100 that came through. But I know it was a little hectic. But so we were trying, even in that, to share the gospel. But so last week we looked at three, and we looked at three. We looked at evangelism, we looked at discipleship, and steadfastness. And under this term evangelism, we really would have called it missions. Because what we find was Paul was always trying to go someplace where nobody else had been, where people had never heard the story of Jesus. And what I told you was, in America, there are a lot of people, they may know the name of Jesus, but they've never really heard the story. They don't know the true story, and I would be willing to guess they don't know your story. And so under this evangelism are missions. You can go to your next door neighbor across the street or wherever it may be, and if God opens that door, you can tell them the story of the Lord Jesus Christ. Tell him how he's changed you. And that's all God asks us to do, is tell what we know. So that would be under evangelism. Under discipleship, we've said that young people who come into Christ are young believers. They need someone to mentor them. They need someone to teach them how to live faithfully. You say, well, I'm not a teacher and I can't do that. Well, that's not what I'm asking you to do. That's not what God asks you to do. It's simply come and walk along beside somebody and give them good wisdom, good advice, because you've experienced in the past. Now, if you can have Bible study with them, by all means, you do need to do that. Teach them how to pray. Teach them how to live the Christian life. That's all it means to be a discipler. Is just teach them what you know. And then the last thing we looked at last week was steadfastness. And that simply means don't quit. It was hard on the Apostle Paul. I mean, he had to make tents for a while. He had to work in order to stay at Corinth, in order to continue to do what God had called him to do. Ministry's not always easy. It's not always something that's fun even. You know, I guarantee it wasn't fun for Paul to be stoned as many times as he was, or to be beaten as he was. That wasn't fun times. But he remained steadfast. He didn't quit. He never gave up. And so those are the three things we looked at last week. I want us to think of three more this week. And the first one is this of being a teacher. We see that in the life of Paul. And we find it in verse 4. And it said, and Paul reasoned in the synagogue every Sabbath and persuaded both the Jews and the Greeks. As was his custom, Paul went to the synagogue. He always went to his people first. In the synagogue, he found those who were God seekers. Now, they thought they had found the way, actually, but God has provided a better way, a new way through the Lord Jesus. And so Paul would always go where there were people who were at least seeking God. They would be the ones most interested. But when he was there, the Bible says that he reasoned with them and he persuaded them. Now, you see, Paul didn't just go and preach and then walk away to the next place.
Paul would share his message, his sermon, but then he would literally sit down with the people that stayed around, and he would reason with them. That it, he would have dialogue with them. He would listen to their questions, and he would answer their questions. Here's what I believe. Here's what God has taught me. Here's the things I've experienced in my life. And he would reason with them logically so that it would make sense that the Old Testament was pointing to the Messiah, and now Jesus fulfilled the Messiah. He simply sat down and talked with them. And you can say, well, I'm not a teacher. You don't have to be. You simply sit down and talk with people. Tell them what you believe and why you believe that. Why is it that you believe in Jesus? Well, I grew up going to church. My mom and dad believed in the Lord Jesus, so I was always there. But I heard the message myself. And as I was getting older, God began speaking to my heart. And so all of a sudden, I don't have my mom and dad's religion. I have a relationship with Christ myself. You see, you simply tell them what you've experienced. And ever since that day happened in my life, God has been with me. And I can tell you time and time again how the Lord has protected me, how he's delivered me from sickness. I can show you how I was going in the wrong direction and God just closed the door. I mean, that's all it means to teach somebody what you know. But it goes on. It says not only did he reason with them, he also says there in verse 4 that Paul persuaded them. And this word persuaded, it's a little more forceful. It means he engaged with them, and not only did he just have conversation with them, Paul pleaded with them. He encouraged them to accept what he was teaching, to accept what he was trying to get across to them. Now, some were Greeks, but many of them were Jewish people. And so they knew a lot of Scripture. And so Paul would encourage them to check out the facts and see if they don't agree that Jesus fulfilled all that. But he didn't just throw out a sermon and then walk away. He spent time with them. Listen to what Jude says. Jude 23, this verse is... It's almost a scary verse as well, but hear what Jude says. Jude says, well, in verse 22, and on some have compassion, making a distinction, but others save with fear, pulling them out of the fire, hating even the garment defiled by the flesh. You see, this is what I picture Paul doing, pulling them out of the fire. Paul would share his story, his message, and he would tell them all the proof, all the truths that he knew that Christ, that Jesus was the Christ. And then Paul, as if they were literally dangling over the fire, would seek to persuade them. Listen, give your life to Christ today before it's too late. And so Paul would teach them. He would teach them the truths found in the Word of God. So he knew God's Word. But also he would share his own life experiences. He could tell how good God had been to him. He could tell, you say, well, Paul, man, all the things Paul experienced, that he was beaten and he was shipwrecked. But Paul would say this way, though, yeah, I was shipwrecked, but every single time God protected me, God spared me, God delivered me. You see, he would see the cup half full instead of half empty. And so he would simply share what he knew about Jesus. And you can do the same thing. You can do the exact same thing. Tell people why it is you go to church. Why is it you're here? Yeah, you've been born again. You've been saved. Okay, wonderful. Tell them that. Tell them that as you come to church each week, that you get rejuvenated. You sing praises to the Lord. You're grateful to him for the week that you've had and how good he's been to you. Tell them that as you come to church, that you feel his presence. You're here among brethren where two or three are gathered. He's there also. And I come and I sing praises and I go home and I'm ready to meet a new week. Explain why you go to church. It's not just because mom and dad said I had to. No, I want to go. I get my cup refilled when I go. That's why I won't go to church. Tell them all the things that God has done for you. Tell them why you serve him. Tell them why you gave your monies or why you brought candy and gave to these children this past week. Explain to them. Well, you know, yeah, it was Halloween, but at church, we see it a different way. We call it a fall festival, But we have people come through so that we can just love on them and share with them and tell them about Christ when we get opportunity. And hopefully some of those people, when they start looking for a church home, maybe they'll come and visit us. I mean, you just tell them why I serve, why I give.
And it all comes back to the fact that I love the Lord. He's changed my life, and I'll never be the same. Tell them about the good times. Tell them about joyful times. Tell them about how your children were little and how much fun you had with them and how you saw God change their lives when they gave their life to Christ. And you could see the difference that God's made in their life. You just tell them your story. And that's witnessing, yes, but it's teaching. And you say, well, I don't have the gift of teaching. Well, we're not asking you to take a class in Sunday school. We're just saying, share with people what you know. Teach them from your experiences. That's what Paul would do. So we have this teaching. The next one is witnessing, though, and I find it in verse 7. He says in verse 7 and verse 8, and he departed from there, Paul did, and entered the house of a certain man named Justus, one who worshiped God, whose house was next door to the synagogue. So what happens for old Paul? Paul gets kicked out of the synagogue. He stirred up the hornet's nest there. The Jews don't like him. So what does he do? He goes to the house right next door to the synagogue. Because remember, people have heard the message already. He sat down and he's visited with them. He's answered some of their questions. There's others who have more questions. And so Paul intentionally, he doesn't want to go all the way outside of town. He sowed some seed right here. And so he goes right next door to this guy's house. But notice, this guy is a Gentile. He's not a Jew. Now that's a no-no for a Jewish man. You don't enter into the home of a Gentile. You become unclean when you do that. You certainly don't stay there and live there. But you see, Paul has come to understand that the gospel was for all people. On the road to Damascus, when Jesus spoke to Paul, he had a plan for Paul. And then when Ananias was questioned about Paul, the Lord said, listen, I have something special for him. He's going to go to Gentiles, to Jews, and to kings. He's going to touch all nations, all kinds of people. He's a special servant of mine. But what we see in Paul was Paul had come to identify himself not just as a Jew, but as a created being of God, a vessel to share the message with all people. And there was no prejudice of any kind. I can tell you on Thursday night, we had Caucasian people come through. We had Hispanic people come through. We had people of color come through. We had people from all kinds of nations. And see, I mean, God sent us all kinds of folks. And we didn't say, well, I'm sorry, you're not a Caucasian. You can't have our candy. We didn't do that. We'd never do that. You're welcome here. We hope you'll come back and visit with us. And I hope that as we get a chance to go visit some of them, that they will come and participate in our worship and serve here and worship here. And I hope you're ready for that. I hope you're ready for a Hispanic family to come walking in that back door one day and sitting down here worshiping with us. I hope you're ready for that, because that's what we need to be ready for. We are here to share the gospel with all people. All people, red, yellow, white, black, and white, doesn't matter. God loves all people, and that's what Paul discovered. He says, oh my goodness, I'm here to witness to not just the Jews, but to every person that I come in contact with. It says in verse 8, then Crispus, the ruler of the synagogue, believed on the Lord with all his household, and many of the Corinthians, hearing, believed and were baptized. You see, what happened is when people hear the gospel story, many believe. Many come to saving faith. If they don't know the story, they've never heard the gospel truth. When they hear it, the Spirit of God convicts them and they believe. And it doesn't matter what color their skin is, doesn't matter what their background is, unless they're just so religious and so full of pride they refuse to hear. But notice what it says. They heard. They listened to the message. They heard the message, and God used it and spoke to them, and many came to saving faith. Listen, that is what God is inviting you and I to do. All He asks us to do is go to whosoever will. Whosoever will listen. Whosoever will hear. Notice what Paul said. He told the Jews, but when he shook his garments off, verse 6, he says, but when they opposed him and blasphemed, he shook his garments and said to them, your blood be on your own head. You see, if somebody refuses to listen to your story, if they reject the Lord Jesus, you're not responsible for that person anymore. They have made their decision. Their blood is on their head. All you were asked to do was tell your story. And that's all that you have to do. Paul, the Jews have rejected him. And so he says, okay, Jewish people, you know, I love you. But if you're not going to listen, I'm going to go to where people will hear and where they will respond, where they've never heard before. And he moved on. And for us, for me anyways, one of the hardest decisions for us to know is, how long do I keep witnessing to this person? Over and over and over, and they keep rejecting. Well, I think we just, as long as I have opportunity, I do. But it may be I have to quit focusing on that person and find someone two blocks away that might listen. And I just have to move on and share my story with them. You know, until God tells me to quit witnessing to them, I don't think I ever quit. But they have that choice to make. And if they make that decision, I don't want to hear anymore, then I honor that. There are people around here that have no trespassing signs at their driveway. I don't go up them. I mean, they obviously do not want me to come up or knock on their door. They put a no trespassing sign, do not enter. And so I don't. You say, well, you should. Well, I don't think I should. They've told me don't come here. I'm not interested in anything you have. And so I don't. We're to be witnesses. Witness to those people who will hear, those people who will listen. You say, well, I don't have any abilities. I can't talk. I'm not a great speaker. Would you believe that Paul was timid as well? We're going to see in just a minute where God had to encourage Paul. Paul, don't be afraid. I'm with you. Paul was timid as well. God uses weak things. He does. He likes to take the weak. If we're so strong and able to do things in our own strength and ability, we get the glory. God doesn't. God likes to use those things that are weak, and you don't think you can do it without His power. And He'll use you. In the book of Philippians, Paul writes, he was in a Roman prison. Now, that's a pretty weak position, right? He's not leading a church. He's not out on the streets of Jerusalem preaching. He's not anywhere. He's in a Roman prison. But the Bible says that the whole palace guard has now heard the gospel message, because they would put four men at a time in charge of Paul, and he would witness to those four, and they would change guards, and he got four brand new ones. And he was constantly telling people about Christ. And the whole palace guard heard the story. Why was that? Because Paul was put into a weak position. He was in jail. He couldn't go anywhere. He couldn't make any decisions. They made all those decisions for him, and yet God used him. Listen, God will do the same thing for you. You may feel weak. You may feel like, I can't talk. But God uses ordinary people to do extraordinary things, as He did Paul. So we see there's a teaching aspect of our lives. We can teach others from our experiences. We can witness by opening our mouth and telling them what God has done, what joys you experience with that. But also you can be an encourager. And we find that Paul desperately was in need of encouragement at this time in his life. We find it in verse 9. Now the Lord spoke to Paul in the night by a vision. Do not be afraid, but speak. Do not keep silent. Verse 10, I am with you. Now, we kind of touched on this a little bit last week, not intentionally trying to give away our next point, but it was needed. But Paul was apparently fearful. Our God wouldn't have told him this in the vision. He would not have had this dream. And God says, Paul, it's okay. Don't be afraid. Well, think about what Paul has experienced. Let me read in 2 Corinthians. We know Paul experienced a lot, but he shares some things with us in 2 Corinthians chapter 4. And as I read it, you'll remember this. In verse 7, Paul says this: "But we have this treasure in earthen vessels, that the excellence of the power may be of God and not of us. We are hard pressed." Let me see, is that the right one? "We are hard pressed on every side, not yet not crushed." That's not what I'm looking for, folks. Paul says, anyways, he tells that he was in a shipwreck 3 times. He's been stoned, and he explains all those different things. But I have another list, so I'll go to it instead. Here's what he says. Paul was threatened in Damascus in Acts chapter 9. He was threatened again in Jerusalem. He was persecuted, and he was run out of Antioch Pisidia in Acts 13. He faced stoning in Iconium in Acts 14. He was stoned and left for dead at Lystra in Acts 14. He experienced the loss of a dear friend and companion when Barnabas left with John Mark. He knew what it meant for Barnabas to do that. He was beaten with rods and imprisoned at Philippi, Acts 16. He had been cast out of Philippi again in Acts 16. His life was threatened at Thessalonica, and he was forced out of Berea in Acts 17. Paul understood what it meant for people to threaten his life. At this point, Paul must have been thinking, all right, the Jews have run me out of the synagogue, and it won't be much longer. They're gonna stone me and take me out to the city gates again. And so he must have been thinking either about leaving or just not saying anything else for a while. It's time to let things calm down, perhaps, is what he was thinking. But instead, the Lord came to him in a vision, and Paul, and he said, "Look, Paul, it's okay, don't be afraid." Notice what he says. What is it that keeps you calm? Verse 10, "I am with you." Listen, you know what? There's sometimes when our people need somebody to come along beside of them and simply remind them that God is with them. You're not in this by yourself. You're not alone. I know you're hurting right now. You've lost your loved one. God is with you. You can be an encourager. Barnabas, the man Barnabas, was called the son of encouragement. And if you look through the book of Acts, Barnabas was always encouraging people to be faithful to God. Now, I tried to figure out that son of encouragement. Why was he called son of encouragement? Was his dad an encourager? Is that what it means? Well, I don't think so, because James and John were called sons of thunder. And it wasn't because Zebedee was a thunderous man. It was because they wanted to call fire down on the Samaritans. And so Jesus gave them the name sons of thunder. That is, that's just that's their personality. They're wanting to be loud and boisterous. And if somebody disagrees with me, I'll just rain fire down on you. So Barnabas is son of encouragement. Barnabas was always the one who would encourage. Barnabas went and found Paul, who at that point was Saul of Tarsus, and brought him to introduce him to the disciples to begin with. He encouraged Paul to fulfill his calling. Barnabas took John Mark whenever Paul had a disagreement with him, and Barnabas took John Mark, who later became valuable to Paul, and discipled him and trained him. Barnabas was the encourager. You may not be a teacher. You may not be a speaker. You may not be a leader, but you can be an encourager. You can always give an encouraging word. Remind people that God is with them. Remind people that God will work things out. All things work together for good. You can do that. That's a gift that you have. You say, well, is that a spiritual gift? Well, you may have the spiritual gift of encouragement, but everybody can be an encourager. You can do that. Mr. Buddy Glasscock shared with me on Sunday nights, probably once a month, as Buddy was leaving, Buddy would stop and he'd say, "Brother Chris, I really enjoyed your sermon today. It really spoke to my heart." And I was appreciative of that. And he would do that at least once a month. And one Sunday night he stopped and he said, "Well, brother," I can't remember his name, it was a pastor he had at Fairview, said, "he told me one time that nobody ever thanks me for my messages that it spoke or they encouraged them." And he said, when people did that, that really helped him out. This is what that pastor told Buddy. And Buddy said, "So I've always made it a point to make sure that ever so often I encourage my pastor, thanking him for the messages that he preached." And that really, that picks you up. That makes you feel good that somebody
is listening, and it speaks to heart. Somebody from this congregation just told me that last Sunday morning. You know who you are, and thank you for doing that. It does matter.
You can be an encourager. So we're talking about these spiritual giftedness, talking about using our gifts, our abilities, our talents for the kingdom of God.
And what I've tried to see from the life of Paul is it's simply living as a child of God, living a life that is being obedient. I'm going to witness. I'm going to share my story. I'm going to encourage people. I'm going to try and be a mentor, a discipler. I'm going to do what I can do for the kingdom of God. Now, you may have a special gift from God as a teacher. By all means, teach in our Sunday school hour. Yes, do that. But just because you don't have that gift doesn't mean you can't teach others.
I hope to goodness you taught your children. And I hope to goodness you're now teaching your grandchildren, if you have them, about Jesus.
And you don't have to have any kind of special gift. You just tell them what He's done for you and what He'll do for them. It's that easy. It's that simple.
And so where are you at? I started this out about talking about being faithful. I don't remember how I did that this morning. What's it mean to be faithful? I don't think I did I?
To be faithful, it means that a person, I'm committed to that purpose or that person that I have made that commitment to, and I remain committed. I'm going to be faithful. We talked about being dependable. That if I tell you I'm going to do something, I'm going to do that. I'm going to be dependable.
Trustworthy. A man's right hand means something still. Can our church trust you to be there and to be faithful and to help us? And so I would ask you, are you being faithful? Are you being dependable? Are you being trustworthy to what God has called and asked you to do? Can our church count on you to be faithful, dependable, and trustworthy? You can make a commitment, a recommitment, whatever you want to call it, today. Lord Jesus, I've not been as faithful as I should have been. I've not as dependable. I've not been as trustworthy.
Using my gifts, my monies, my talents, whatever it is for you. But God, I want everybody to know you. I want them to know what you've done for me. And so starting today, I will live for you.
You can do that today. I'm going to ask you to stand. Heads are bowed and eyes are closed. I want to pray with you, and then we'll have our invitation time.
Just pray that God's will is done in our lives, every one of us. Our Father in heaven, Lord, King of kings, Lord of lords, we thank you, God, that you've called us. You've chosen us, Lord. You reached down and plucked us out of that fire that Jude spoke about. And when we were on our way, doomed for devil's hell, and God, you sought us out. You found us and you saved us. And Lord, we thank you for that. And Father, out of a grateful heart, we want to live for you. We want to be faithful. And God, it's not as complicated as sometimes we try to make it. It's simply living for you, being faithful, being dependable, being trustworthy. So God, today we make that commitment. From this day forward, we're going to live for Jesus. All that we do for His honor and glory. Lord, may we do that commitment. May we make that commitment. And God, help us to live it out. And Father, we ask it in the name of Jesus. Amen.